11:12-14. Now the next day, when he had come out of Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing from afar a fig tree having leaves, he went to see if perhaps he would find something on it. When he came to eat, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. In response, Jesus said to him, "Let no one eat fruit from you ever again." And the disciples added. Verse 20. Now in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, remembering, said to him, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree which you caused has withered away." So Jesus answered and said to them, "Have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believe that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you will have them." Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So we all know the story. Jesus came to a tree. The tree had leaves. But when he got there, he discovered that there was no fruit on it. Hallelujah. Then he spoke, "No one ever eats fruit from you again." This morning I'm looking at what I call evergreen trees. When Israel was going into the promised land, somewhere in the book of Numbers 13, Moses sent some spies to the land to go and see whether the things they've been promised is very true. And in verse 23 of Numbers 13, the Bible said those spies, they came to the valley of Eshcol, and they cut down a branch with one cluster of grapes. They carried it between two of them on a pole. They also brought some pomegranates and figs. The place was called the valley of Eshcol because of the cluster. Eshcol means cluster. It means the fruits were big, which the men of Israel cut down there. And they returned from spying out the land after 40 days. Now when they divided and came back to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of children of Israel in the wilderness of Paran and Kadesh, they brought back word to them and all the congregation and showed them the fruits of the land. And they told him, saying, "We went to the land where you truly sent us, it truly flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit." And you know, they began to tell Moses, "There are strong people in the land, they are the sons of Anak, we can't eat, we can't take the land," and all those things. So much that in chapter 14, all Israel began to weep for this report. And when they began to weep, in fact, they chose for themselves leaders to take them back to Egypt. God began to speak to Moses in verse 20, Numbers 14, verse 20 to 24. When Moses began to pray for these people, because God said, "I'm going to wipe them away because they don't believe in me," then the Lord said, "I have pardoned according to your word." God pardoned according to the word of Moses. "But truly as I live, all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord. Because all these men who have seen my glory and the signs which I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, and have put me to the test these 10 times, have not heeded my voice, they shall certainly not see the land which I sold to their fathers, nor any of those who rejected me see it." In the first place we read, Jesus said, "Nobody eats of this tree again." In this place, God was speaking, nobody of this generation will step into the promised land. God released the word over the tree as he released the word over this generation. If you go to verse 28 to 34 of that Numbers 14, say to them, as I live, says the Lord, just as you have spoken in my ear, so I will do to you. The carcass of you who have complained against me shall fall in this wilderness. All of you who are numbered according to your entire number, from 20 years old and above, except for Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun, you shall by no means enter the land which I swore I will make you to dwell in. But your little ones, of whom you said will be victims, I will bring them, and they shall know the land which you have despised. But as for you, your carcass shall fall in this wilderness. And your son shall be shepherd in the wilderness 40 years and bear the brunt of your infidelity until the carcass are consumed in the wilderness. Verse 34. According to the number of days in which you spied out the land, 40 days for each day you shall bear the guilt 1 year, namely 40 years, and shall know my rejection. Praise the Lord. So God spoke to a generation and said, none of them, no matter their number, we ever step into the promised land, as he spoke to the tree that no one will ever eat of his fruit. But God singled out somebody, two people from that generation. In verse 24, he said, but my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit in him, and he has followed me fully, I'll bring him into the land where he went, and his descendants are inheriting. He spoke about it again in verse 30. Except for Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, the son of Nun, you shall by no means enter the land which I saw I will make you to dwell in. God doesn't cut down just any tree. God observes before God releases a word. Jesus saw a fig tree, and it was full of leaves. And Jesus wanted fruit on it. And when he came close, he found nothing. Then he said, no man ever eats from you again. In Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 19 and 20, God spoke to Israel how they would treat different type of trees. And I want to tell you that this season we treat different types of people in different ways, depending on the kind of spirit that you are made of. He said, except for Caleb. So God found an exceptional man in the midst of a generation that he said none of them was going to step into the promised land. In Deuteronomy 20, verse 19, God spoke to Israel, when you besiege a city for a long time, while making war against it to take it, you shall not destroy its trees by wielding an axe against them. If you can eat of them, that is, any tree you can find fruit on should stand. You cannot destroy a tree if you can eat of them. Do not cut them down. Do not to use in the seed. For the tree of the fruit of the field is a man's food. Verse 20. Only the trees which you know are not trees for food, you shall destroy and cut down to build seed walls against the city, to make war until it is subdued. So God differentiated the tree that will stand and the tree that will go down. As he differentiated Caleb from a generation that is going to be wasted in the wilderness. I'm praying for you that you will not just be a tree, you will be a fruitful tree. You will be an evergreen tree. A tree that God will make a distinction with in the name of Jesus Christ. And it is in the New Testament. In John chapter 15 from verse 1 to 8, John chapter 15 verse 1 to 8, Jesus began to speak. He said, I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. What he did with the fig tree, when it comes and it doesn't find fruit, he takes it away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. God doesn't deal with every tree in the same way. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. Yes. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire and they are burned. But if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. Verse 8, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. There are different reactions to different trees depending on the fruit that is on them. So in Matthew chapter 3 verse 10, he said, the root is laid, the axe is laid at the root of every tree. Which does not bear fruit, it is cut down and thrown into the fire. He emphasizes it again in Matthew 7 verse 15 to 20. Matthew 7 verse 15 to 20. He says, you should beware of false prophet. He said, because by their fruit we know them. Verse 18 said, a good tree cannot bear bad fruit. A bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruit you will know them. God looks at trees and he determines which one should stand and which one should fall according to what he finds on them. I pray that as Jesus is looking into our life, he will find fruit in us and he will command freshness upon us. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Joshua chapter 14, verse 6 to 15, 40 years after that experience, 40 years, all around Caleb had been tense. But a different experience was happening to Caleb. The Bible told us, then the children of Judah came to Joshua and Gilgal, Joshua 14 verse 6. And Caleb the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, you know the word which the Lord said to Moses, the man of God, concerning you and me in Kadesh Barnea. May the word that God will speak concerning you be a favorable word. Yeah. And you know, sometimes it's not just a prayer point. It's about the fruit of life that you are producing. What God speaks to you is determined by what God meets in you. And that's why it's important that God meets faith in our lives as we are following it. He said, you know the word. Ask your neighbor, which word did God speak concerning you? It's important you know what God is saying concerning you, because that's what you are going to use to contend with everything the enemy is bringing against you. You must not just listen to the reports that are outside. You must listen to the report that is within you. Caleb had a report that was contrary to the experience that was happening around him. Because for 40 years, God wasted a generation he belonged to, but he had another word that separated him from that generation. And so the Bible says, he told Joshua, you know the word. He said, I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me to Kadesh Barnea to spy the land. And I brought him word to him as it was in my heart. That's one of the things I've been challenged with this season. All the psychedelic faith people claim to have has been tested. Because most people don't speak from their heart. They speak from convenience. Most people are convenient believers. But now, we need people who are speaking from the depth of your heart. Jesus said, if you speak to this mountain, and you will not doubt in your heart, God needs the compression of what is happening within you with what is expressed by you. God needs a generation that really has an harmony with what they are proclaiming and what is happening within them. If we have never had a hidden life, it would have been a great challenge. I spoke the word as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren who went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord.
It's very important.
I remember March 22nd, the last day we had a public gathering in this place. The title of the sermon was Devotion. Your devotion has been tested. How much you follow has been tested. But I wholly, not partially, I with everything inside of me follow the Lord my God. You have had enough excuses not to follow. There have been social distancing. There have been, you couldn't see people as you want to see them. You couldn't go where you wanted to go. You couldn't even go to church. And these are the things that will test how much of wholeness is in your heart in the following. So Moses saw that day saying, surely the Lord, surely the land where your foot has trodden shall be your inheritance and your children forever. Because you have wholly followed the Lord my God. Now, behold, the Lord has kept me alive. Someone said, the Lord has kept me alive.
The Lord has kept me alive.
Yeah, there's a way. You see, there's something about trees. Trees can live for 200 years. Trees have a way of outlasting even the person who planted them.
Yeah.
Now, Moses who gave the promise was not there. But yet, the one that the promise was given to was there. The Lord has kept me alive. He said, these 45 years, ever since the Lord spoke this word, every word of God over you will stand.
Yeah.
None of them will fall to the ground.
Yeah.
Listen to me, embrace that future you saw. Nothing is going to cut you short from seeing it. You are going to stand in the midst of your prophecy. You are going to stand in the midst of the purpose of God for your life. If it takes 50 years, you will see it again. They concluded because they sold Joseph that he was dead. He's a 70-year-old boy sold to slavery. The chances of living is slim. So they went back home and said, he's actually dead. They approximated. Your life is not an approximation. Your life is a life of accuracy. As God said it, so shall it be. And I speak to you, you belong to the living. I speak to you, you belong to the victorious. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. These 45 years, ever since the Lord spoke the word to Moses, why Israel wandered in the wilderness? I wonder. We were just going right, left, and center. He said, but now I am this day 85 years old. As yet, I am as strong this day as on the day. 45 years changed nothing. For a man that has an appointment with destiny, it does not matter whether they close it down for 6 months or 9 months. Some of you are still praying in the Holy Ghost. Some of you are still hearing God fresh because you are evergreen trees of righteousness. 5 years. If in 3 months your life has gone down, maybe your own tree shed leaves. But I want, this is the purpose of God for all of us, that we will be evergreen trees. It doesn't matter how long it will take. You are not a fig tree that is fruitless. That in one night, from mulch tree leaves, it was dry wood. And so many people show very great promises and end very bad. But that's not your portion.
Amen.
Because you are evergreen.
I am evergreen.
Somebody say, I'm evergreen.
I am evergreen.
Somebody say, I am strong this day.
I am strong.
As I have been years past. And I will be strong for the days to come. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Things are coming on the face of the earth. Many things that we have not even made plan for. But none of them will change what God said.
Amen.
Say, yes, I'm strong this day as I was. The day Moses sent me out, just as my strength was then, so now is my strength for war. Who is still praying like you used to pray? Who is still studying like you used to study? Who is still prophesying like you used to pray? Who still believe God heals like you used to believe? My strength for war is still the same today. My faith is not challenged. My faith is not, it's still my year of harvest.
Amen.
I say, it's still my year of harvest. My strength for war is still the same as it was 40 years ago. We are nearing the same.
seventh month, but God has not changed. My strength for war is still the same as it was 40 years ago, for going out and for coming in.
For going out and coming in. How many of you cast your mind back to things you used to do when you were in secondary school? Can you still do that? This is a miracle. Now, when you bend to just change your tire, in 15 minutes you have back in. There was a time you never felt it. But Caleb was not like that. He was still bending and holding the sword and found himself standing up straight again without any difference between a 40-year-old man and an 85-year-old man. This is how the word keeps you alive. God spoke to a generation, I'm wasting you. He spoke to another one, I'm keeping you. What is the word for me? The Lord is keeping me. His eyes are on me. Somebody said, the eyes of the Lord are on me. Glory be to God. This is what it means to be evergreen, ever fresh. It's no challenge. Somebody says, it's no challenge.
Some people say, oh, the pastors are dying because they didn't close open church.
I saw a man who preached twice daily for 3 months and the list of this of meeting on social media was about 1.5 hours. 3 months every day, sometimes 3 times. Say evergreen.
Evergreen.
Some people try 3 days. Some people feel God called them, then in 2 weeks they've preached everything they know. From Genesis to Revelation, from prayer to fasting. And they say, what else? I saw that freshness. And that when I saw it, I said, God, this is the dimension I'm trusting you for. You can't get too tired so easily. In Psalm 92, verse 12 to 15, this is the promise of God for us. Psalm 92, verse 12 to 15. The righteous shall flourish like a palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon.
Amen.
Yes. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Somebody say, I will flourish.
I will flourish.
Spiritually, physically, mentally, I will flourish. Listen, sometimes the lockdown created some sickness for certain people. Because if we are just locked down, it can become depression. You know, and so sometimes people don't even know whether they are sick or they are troubled. But some people wrote books in the lockdown.
Yeah.
It was a retreat for some people. You will flourish.
Yeah.
I said you will flourish.
Yeah.
The Bible says they will flourish in the house of God. They shall still bear fruit in old age. They shall be fresh. Who is going to be fresh?
I will be fresh.
Spirit, soul, and body. They will be
fresh.
Now people say some pastors have lost their calling. There was no time and offering. They shall be
fresh.
Because when your church is raised, they don't even need a gathering to further the kingdom. They shall be fresh. Somebody say, I will be fresh.
I will be fresh.
Nothing has challenged my giving life.
Fresh God.
Nothing has challenged my prayer life. Nothing has challenged my love life. In fact, the more this challenge rises, the more I'm seeing a generation fall off, the more I'm rising. That is what the experience of Caleb. He saw 40 years all his friends dying out, but he was going in the opposite direction. God will give you strength to go in the opposite direction of what your generation is going. When they are faithless, you will be full of faith. When they are turning their back on God and becoming atheists, you'll be a man of faith because you are an evergreen tree of righteousness. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
They shall bear fruit in their own day. They shall be fresh and flourishing. Verse 15. They shall declare that the Lord is upright. He is my rock and there is no unrighteousness in him. Somebody say the Lord is upright. Say over me, he will show his uprightness. Say over me, it will show his favor. So shall it be in the name of Jesus Christ. In Isaiah chapter 65, verse 20 to 23, Isaiah 65, verse 20 to 23, God began to give us this promise a promise that is very important for us to take very conscious heed to.
He said, no more shall there be an infant from there live for a few days,
nor an old man that has not fulfilled his days.
For the child shall die at 100 years. Meaning, if somebody dies at 100, they will say he's a baby.
Are we together?
Yes.
There was one man of God that said, they were praying for him and said, when he was 70, you will be 80. He said, amen. You will be 90. Amen. 100, he said, he answered everything. He said, there was someone who said, 120, he said, hey, just keep quiet. He said, what sin will I have sinned against God that will keep me in this evil world for 120 years? But at least he was able to stretch his own to 90, to almost 100. There are people that are at 45, they care about them, but I'm not going. I have no appointment with death. Some say I have no appointment, not even with sickness, not even with affliction. The Bible said, he said the child shall die at 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. It shall be the description of a sinner. Look at what he said. Yeah. He said, they will build houses and inhabit them. They will plant vineyards and eat their food. Yes. They shall not build and another man inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, you can't number the days of a tree. There are trees. If you go to some Yoruba land, this tree has been here from the foundation of this town. The person who planted the tree is gone. And the tree is still there. There are trees in Jerusalem that are over 2,000 years. Trees of the Bible days. They are still there. In fact, there are some of them are part of the what people go to see for tour for as tourists and attraction. So when God says the days of my people will be as the days of the tree. The tree is so strong. How many of you have tried to kill a tree before? You wanted, like my mother used to remember, you know, we had these three big trees in front of our fence, and at the time they were threatening the fence, almost pulling them down. So my mother made it a mission to make sure that these trees dry up. The problem is that sometimes she would remove all the bark, put salt, put angel oil, it would dry. Then after some time, you just need to. The tree said, who told you I'm gone? I'm still here. I like that word. Bira. I'm just still here. That is the mystery of trees. It takes a lot to extinguish them. If you are easily discouraged, maybe you are not operating like an evergreen tree. It should take a lot for you to change course. It will change a lot for you to stop believing. It will take a lot for you to become faithless. Because your faith was not built on the wisdom of men. It was built on the power of God. For as the days of a tree, so shall the days of my people be. My elect, who is the elect of God here?
I am the elect.
They shall long enjoy the works of their hand. In the name of Jesus, I'm seeing your 40th birthday. I'm seeing your 50th birthday. I'm seeing your 60th birthday. I'm seeing you at 70. And at that time, Nigeria would have transformed. We will long enjoy the works of our hand. We will see our prayers answered. The things we joined our faith together for and trusted God for over our children, you will see it. You will be like trees, evergreen trees, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. They shall not live.
labor in vain. They shall not bring forth children for trouble. They, for they shall be descendants of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. What God is doing does not just cast over you, it even includes your children. You will see your children. It was a blessing recorded in scripture that after the conflict of Job, he saw his children, and he saw his children's children. It is a blessing. I prophesy over you, you will not be cut off in the midst of your days. You will not be cut off in the midst of your days. You will see your children, and by the power of the Most High God, you will see your children's children. In the name of Jesus Christ. It is the blessing of God. How did it happen? Joseph, Jacob, Caleb said, the Lord had kept me these 40 years. See, church, I want to challenge you and I want to encourage you. This is not the moment to begin to get weak in faith. In fact, this is the moment to abound in faith. In Daniel chapter 2, verse 13 to 28, King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, and he forgot the dream, and he told the astrologers to tell him the dream and to tell him the interpretation. And they told him, King, what you are asking, no king has ever asked it. It's a very unique thing. It has never happened before. And the king said, you people are trying to gain time. So he issued a decree. And he said, they should go and start killing every wise man. And he started looking for Daniel. And his friends could kill him. And for some of us, we say, why did I come here? Why am I in Babylon? Why did I enter the privileged field? Because they are forced to be admitted into the elite club of the astrologers and the wise men. It was a challenge of faith. At one point in your life, what you are speaking about free is going to be challenging to say it. I know you keep saying God answers prayer, but you get to a junction in your life where it will take inner energy, spiritual power to say God answers prayer. Because you will see too many things that seem not to be lying on. The truth of the matter is that day, Daniel was as ignorant as any astrologer. He was as confused as any person. And many a times, because you are a man of faith, does not mean you don't fear them. You don't sense their fear. Or you don't even see some of the things that they go through. But you can't react like they react. The Bible said, Daniel went to this man and said, give us a few days. Some people were running from the executioner. Daniel went to the executioner and said, don't worry, it's a matter of time, the answer will come. And what did he do? He went to pray. God show us. We must not die with this. We must not die. We can't deny that the executioner, the sword of the executioner is in the field and is touching people. We can't deny it, but we cannot die with these people. And the Bible said that night, God opened the eyes of Daniel and showed him the dream. What you will do that will exempt you, God will show it to you. Amen. Your eyes of understanding are enlightened. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. And verse 46 to 49, Daniel went to the king and told the executioner, don't kill any man anymore. God has spoken. God has spoken. Doesn't matter how faith-filled you are, faith can have its challenges. I just found myself afraid. Yes. Doesn't mean you are failed. And it doesn't mean that you don't love God. But instead of you to retreat, you press into God. In Matthew 14, verse 22 to 33, Jesus saw the disciples on the sea rowing against the tempestuous wind. And they began to walk on water. And when they saw him walking on water, they thought it was a ghost. But he said to them, do not be afraid. It is me. And Peter said, if it is you, bid me to come. Faith always has adventures.
Amen.
You will get to one juncture in your life where you will need radical faith to live.
everybody that is looking for all things to be equal, to reopen the society, wait too long. Peter answered, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. On the water. Who said he wanted to walk on water? Peter, what do you want to do with your own faith? You want to hide? I have faith, but I hide inside the room. What do you want to do with your own faith? And he said, come. And when Peter had come down from the boat, he walked on water. It's not only Jesus that walked on water. Peter walked on water to go through Jesus. Yes? But when he saw that the wind was restored, now, he started walking on water. That means he had faith. But that to have faith does not mean you will not see contradicting situations. Because Jesus did not steal the wind when he called him to walk on water. He didn't want everything to align for them to walk in faith. You walk in faith despite everything the devil is doing. The wind was restored. He was afraid and it began beginning to sink. And that's what we all preach about. It began to sink. But we never look at the fact that he first stepped out. The one who stepped out and began to sink is the one Jesus pulled. Who told you Caleb is not as afraid as every other person? But he brought what? The word as it was in his heart. He said, Lord, save me. And what did the Lord do to Peter? And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said, oh, you're little faith. Why do you doubt? He said, he doubted. But yet he exercised faith. This is the moment where you see that people are having a diminishing experience of faith, or they are going on the upward surge. But because we are evergreen trees, we will abound more.
Amen.
So in 1 Corinthians 15, 57 and 58, 1 Corinthians 15, 57 and 58. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast. Begin to repeat that word after me. Say, be steadfast.
Be steadfast.
Immovable.
Immovable.
Always abounding.
Always abounding.
No, the word always abounding. Always increasing.
Amen.
We look for a way to make the situation to increase us. Are we together? We look for a way to make the situation to what? To increase us. If we can't do one service, then we do two services. But we will stay in the world. Are we together? If we can't pray alone, then we'll find one person to join our faith with to pray. But we will never stop praying. Always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain. Everybody that told you faith is a vain life is denying you of an access. Your labor is not in vain. There is no vanity in prayer. There is no vanity in hearing the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You need to hear and hear again. Are we together? You need to find a community of faith. You need to talk to one another. You need to pray with one another. For your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So the only thing we need to do is to abound more, to be evergreen, to retain freshness, to remain green, and we will remain green.
Amen.
I said we will remain green.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let me quickly read some scriptures as I tire. Psalm 37 verse 18 to 20. The Lord knows the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time. And in the days of famine, they shall be satisfied. And the wicked shall perish. And the enemies of the Lord, like the splendor of the meadows, shall vanish. Into smoke, they shall vanish away. When some people are being satisfied, some people are vanishing. You will not vanish. Let me put it in Yoruba. And in white. Your seat will not be empty.
Your seat will not be empty. Your seat will not be empty. Your place will not be empty. You will look for everything God has given to you, and nothing will be missing. Nothing will be missing. Nothing will be on the keyboard. Nothing will be missing. 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 I'm sending the word on your behalf to a place you cannot go today. Wherever you have the bad news, nothing will be missing. Nothing will be missing. Nothing will be missing. In the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ. Verse 25 and 26 of that Psalm 37. Verse 25. I have been yoked. Now I am whole. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his descendants begging bread. Verse 26. He is ever. Somebody say evergreen. Is ever merciful. He's not tired of ministry. Yes. Some people are tired of ministry. He is ever merciful. He is ever hopeful. He is ever seeing a chance in somebody's life. He is ever extending a long rope to people that don't seem to deserve it. He is ever merciful and lends. Some people can't touch. Some people can't hold. They have been restrained. Their soul has gone shrunk. The same way their physical life has shrunk. That's why they have no connection with anybody. That's why they are not merciful. Some people say, I have need. So in their mind, they shrunk. They cannot be merciful again. It doesn't occur to them that, okay, not everybody has the privilege that I have. Some people lost their job. I have not lost my job. So what is he doing? He's still expanding his mind. He is ever merciful. Somebody say, I am ever merciful. You know why it's so important? If you are ever merciful, you will ever receive mercy. Because the Bible says, if you show mercy, you will receive mercy. The capacity you have built inside of you is going to be a reflection of the capacity you will receive from God. He is ever merciful and led, and his descendants are blessed. Somebody say, I'm blessed.
I am blessed.
Psalm 71, 17, and 18. Oh God, you have taught me from my youth. And to this day, I declare your wondrous works. Now when I'm old and I'm gray-headed, oh God, do not forsake me. Look at this man. He still has plans even when he's old. You are too young to stop dreaming. You are too young to stop believing. Even when I'm old, do not forsake me until I declare your strength to this generation and your power to everyone to come. I will still have some children in class where I will raise a new generation of faith people. When I'm 90, I will just say, I don't want to meet anybody. I want to meet teenagers. These are the people I want to meet. I want to shoot some arrows into the future. I have invested in my generation. I want to invest in another generation that will even take it further. That was what David was saying. And now you are even disconnected from your own generation. Dropping leaves, shedding leaves. You are not evergreen. Somebody say, I'm evergreen. Somebody say, I'm evergreen. Psalm 105, verse 37. The Bible says, when they came out of Egypt, none of them was feeble. Two things. The first tree, Jesus said, nobody eats fruit from you. The second generation, Jesus said, nobody of this generation steps into the land. It was a perfect total exemption for the tree to be eaten and a total exemption for that generation to step into the promised land. But that is not the only time God issues exemption. Look at another one. When he brought them out of Egypt, there was none feeble. These are the only exemptions you have to claim. Someone said these are the exemptions I have to claim. There's no fever among the tree. God can do something that nothing will reflect feebleness on you from your head to your toe. Because nothing reflected fruitfulness on the tree from his leaves to his roots. And the same way, God can say everything around you will reflect fruitfulness even to your old age. No one will be feeble. In Exodus 23 verse 26, he issued another exemption. None of you shall be barren.
Yes. Ah, yeah.
None of you shall be barren. 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 Look at it. Exodus 23 and 26. Exodus 23 and 26. No one shall suffer miscarriage or be barren in your land. I will fulfill the number of your days. Deuteronomy 7:14 for double emphasis. Deuteronomy 7:14. You shall be blessed above all the people. There shall not be a male or female barren among you. But for you to know that it's a serious matter, he said, even your animals, your business will not be barren. Everything that concerns you will not be barren. He said, look around it. The same way Jesus looked at the tree and said, no man eat of your tree, of your fruit. It's the same way Jesus is looking at this church and he's looking everywhere. He's looking at the prayers. He's looking at the thoughts. He's looking at the inner man. He's looking at everything. He's looking at our fears. And he said, none of you shall be barren. None of you can cast their junk. Not one. You will look from the right, from the left, and there will be no barrenness. Lift your hands, everybody, and begin to give him glory today. As evergreen trees of righteousness. Say, Father, Lord, I'm abounding. I'm immovable. Always fruitful. Glorifying the Lord. Shalabo Shetana Mandede. Somebody take the joy and the liberty of praying the Holy Ghost in the congregation for some time. Mandorebo Katadia Tataba. None of you shall be barren. None of you. Let's shake it, glory to glory. Glory to glory. Strength to strength. Joy to joy. Joy to joy. Power to power. Life to life. Peace to peace. Joy to joy. I will not shrink. I will not dry up. I am planted by the rivers of water. There is the life of God in me. Thank you.
Emana gale brande kago pa su taya gara 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 gara.
There's a river inside of me that is able to touch the world. There's a river inside of me that is able to flood the world. There's a river inside of me that is able to flood the world. There's a river inside of me that is able to flood the world. There's a river inside of me that is able to flood the world. There's a river inside of me that is able to flood the world. Let the river flow. And there's a river inside of me that is able to flood the world. one moment. I want you to pray until you sense freshness. Until you sense freshness. Until you sense freshness. Oh, glory be to God. Let the atmosphere be fresh. Let the testimony of our land be fresh. We cast away every old report, every old joke. Makatelia, Shabbatopelia, Rushi, Kappa, Shata, Rakatatada. Somebody remove this black cloud from this atmosphere. Remove this dark cloud from this atmosphere. Remove this darkness, this lack of faith, this hopelessness. Somebody remove it from the atmosphere. Remove it from the atmosphere. Ayakata. You will not be barren. You will not be fruitless. You will not die. You will long enjoy the works of your hand. Somebody prophesy to yourself. Prophesy to your life. More Catarias. Afraid of the Papa to get the door. And bring it to the Catarias. Hello, break it to Malataria. Somebody begin to pray until freshness arise. Be fresh, be renewed, be evergreen. Live in faith, be strong in faith, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Jesus' name we pray. I speak to you. Said the days of my people will be like the days of a tree. You will be found rooted, fresh, producing fruit for many days. You will not be cut off in the midst of your days. In famine. Trees have a way of surviving famine. In fact, some of them have a way of surviving bush burning. They just have that dexterity. In famine, you shall be fed. You shall be satisfied. For your roots are deep on the heart. They are deep in the Lord. Where people do not see hope, you will find hope from the presence of God. The word of the Lord will not be scarce to you.
Amen.
The word of the Lord will not be scarce to you. The voice of the Lord will be clear to you. I pronounce you evergreen. Always abounding. Bearing fruits. Even to old age. So shall it be. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Give the Lord a big hand of praise.